It's nice to see you again. It's always good to be in the Lord's house. I invite you to turn to 2 Corinthians. We're picking up where we left off, whenever that was, so many weeks ago, I forget. But it's 2 Corinthians chapter 7, and you may or may not recall that we left off with 7:1, which I thought was part of the previous section. And we're going to pick up in chapter 7 and verse 2. Can you hear me good in the back there? Yes? All right. Okay, well, let's take some time to speak to our Lord in prayer, and then we're going to launch right into the text, okay? Let's pray. Lord, it's good to be in your house, and I am grateful that the doors are open. And we pray especially for those who cannot be here due to health concerns. We pray for those who are traveling on vacation or business. And for us right here this morning, we pray that your Spirit would be at work in our lives. Give us a hunger. Give us, Lord, a thirst for your word, not just to learn it, but beyond that then to implement it through your grace and your power. We want to bear fruit for you, Lord, because you're worthy of that and much, much more. And so I pray that this would be an act of worship throughout the entire service and it would spill over into the week. Again, Lord, that you might be pleased. We pray all this in the majestic name of Jesus. And all my brothers and sisters said, amen. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, if you're not there, please turn. And this is the title, Repentance Without Regret. Have you seen a traffic sign like that recently? They do have no U-turns and things like that, but I've never seen one like that. All right, so I'm going to tell you about, and for those who are younger, this might be informational for you. They used to have these things in houses called landlines. Anybody know what that's all about? Yeah. In fact, going way back in time, they had landlines where you actually would dial the operator and give her your request, right? And usually you'd dial zero and then give the phone number. Well, back in the days when most people had a landline, there was a little boy who dialed zero and the operator picked up and the boy proceeded to ask her to call a number for him. But unfortunately, he didn't speak too clearly. He mumbled. So he had to keep repeating, say again. And finally, he got frustrated, and he said, "You operators are dumb." And he slammed down the phone just like that. Well, his mother heard that, and she was actually kind of shocked about it. And so she forced him, against his will, to call back that operator and apologize. And so feeling remorse and a little bit of regret, he was reluctant, but nevertheless, he called and he apologized. Well, it didn't end there because later when his mother left the house, he called that operator again. "Is this the same operator I talked to?" She said, "Yes." And he said, "I still think you're dumb." And then he smacked down the phone. Now, he did have regret. He did have some bit of remorse as he apologized the first time. But what did he lack? It's another R word. Repentance, right? So what on earth is repentance, and what's the difference? Because I would argue if you have remorse and regret and even tears maybe, that's what I'm going to call worldly sorrow. And the reason I'm going to call it worldly sorrow is because that's what Paul calls it in the text. And he contrasts that with godly sorrow. And godly sorrow, the difference is godly sorrow has one more piece. There might be remorse, regret, etc., bad feelings. But there's this piece called repentance, which is a biblical concept and also a spiritual reality that should be in all of our lives. It's actually a healthy thing. By the way, it doesn't always feel good. It's kind of like going to the dentist. It doesn't always feel good when that drill comes out, but we feel better afterwards, don't we? And we're glad we went. That is until the bill comes, right? Then that's a different, another pain, second, subsequent pain, you might say. So what is repentance? I'm so glad you asked that question. Well, repentance means to change one's mind about sin, and don't miss it, then as a result, to change one's behavior. To change one's mind about sin, but then as a result, to change one's behavior. Wiersbe puts it well. I like how he words this. He says, regret involves the mind primarily, and remorse involves the emotions. That's where sometimes the tears will come in. And the sorrow. But repentance includes a change of mind, a hatred for sin, and a willingness to make things right. Have you ever done or said something which later you thought about it and you had regret? I mean, I have, probably all of us have. Sometimes we're not tracking on all the cylinders, right? And we say things we think later after the fact, and then there's regret. So what do we do in a situation like that? It's not a comfortable place to be, and maybe somebody was hurt or offended in the process. Do we just leave it where it's at and hope it goes away? What's the solution? Well, the solution is godly repentance. And we're going to learn in this particular text, you'll see it very clearly. In fact, it's in the verses there, that godly repentance leaves no regret. Regret is a very uncomfortable emotion, right? Godly repentance, not worldly, but godly repentance leaves no regret. And that's good news, which means there's hope. Hope for change, hope for better things. And hopefully as we do this, and we're going to talk about how to do this, it becomes a life habit. So then we learn how to deal with conflict and bad choices and broken relationships and the stuff of life that all of us basically face on a regular basis. So we're going to walk through the text, and as we do, we're going to ask the question, why? Why does godly repentance leave no regret? And we're going to see at least three reasons why in this particular text. And if you're ready, here's the first one. Because godly repentance leads to reconciliation with others, which is something we all want. The Lord would ask us to do such, right? If we're on the outs with somebody, our responsibility, as best we can, is to reconcile. Bear in mind, we can't control the other side of the fence, right? But at least as it's up to us, we want to think and act in a way that honors the Lord and in a way that can hopefully bring reconciliation. Maybe over time, doesn't happen overnight sometimes. Sometimes it does. But to at least make the effort for reconciliation. And so if you're there, look at chapter 7. We're in 2 Corinthians chapter 7. And I'd like you to look, please, picking up at verse 2, where Paul says, "Make room for us in your hearts. We wronged no one. We corrupted no one. We took advantage of no one. I do not speak to condemn you, for I have said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together. Great is my confidence in you. Great is my boasting on your behalf. I'm filled with comfort. I am overflowing with joy in all our affliction." Now, Paul is resuming his appeal to the Corinthians. He made an appeal, if you recall, earlier on, where he wanted them to open up their hearts and make some room for him because they were being weaned away from Paul. And we'll talk about the background just as a refresher in just a moment. But if you go back to chapter 6, you should see it right there. Chapter 6, verse 11, he says, "Our mouth has spoken freely to you, O Corinthians. Our heart is opened wide. You are not restrained by us, but you are restrained in your own affections. Now, in a like exchange, I speak as to children," meaning his spiritual children, "open wide to us also." Now, you recall that there was a group in Corinth that challenged Paul's authority. Whatever the issues are, we're not told what all the specifics are, but nevertheless, they did not want to submit to Paul. They did not recognize him as God's authorized apostle. And they basically talked bad about his ministry, his character, his methods. Paul was no good in their eyes. Well, if they would have kept their opinions to themselves, that would have been one thing, but they were trying to recruit others to their position. And subsequently, to add some more problems, another group shows up on the scene, the false apostles. They infiltrate the church. These are Judaizers who promote a different gospel. It's the gospel plus jump through so many hoops. And of course, they have the self-arrogated authority to tell you precisely how large those hoops are, how many there are, and what color they are. This is standard. It's the flesh, basically. I have to do my thing for God. I have to earn my way up, which implies I have the capacity to do such, which is overinflation of ego, I think. If we understood how desperately needy we are for God's grace, we wouldn't be thinking along those lines, right? But nevertheless, this group comes in and they're teaching this additional gospel, which is really error. And they likely found a receptive audience with that group which was in the church, which was challenging Paul's authority. And so, you know, people who are in rebellion will welcome other groups to come in and join the party, right? So now we've got two groups merging together, and these false apostles were also challenging Paul's authority in time, bad-mouthing him, and increasingly they're winning the allegiance of the Corinthians. The Corinthians were turning their heads away from Paul and their hearts and then toward these false apostles. So Paul gets wind of this, and he makes an urgent trip to Corinth to see what he can do about the problem. And it didn't turn out too pretty, as much as we can put it together here. It seems like when he arrived, he was attacked and disrespected by his enemies. And the saddest part is the Corinthians did not speak up. They left Paul to himself. Maybe in their hearts they felt like they should have said something, but they didn't. Have you ever been in that situation where you know you should say something, but you don't for whatever reason, fear of what people might think or whatever? When you sense that urge, pray, make sure your heart is right, but speak. Courage is a wonderful attribute. It's something that's a good part of character, being courageous, assuming we have the truth and we're on the right side of the issue. So nobody defends Paul, so Paul returns to Ephesus and he sits down and writes what we call the sorrowful, tearful letter. It was very severe in its content. It was straight and to the point. And it was designed really to prompt repentance and reconciliation. Paul's heart, and the Lord would bear this out, was love for the Corinthians. He was not just blasting them to get it off his chest and whatever, but rather he loved them and he could see that they were in a bad way spiritually. So he took the time to write this letter, and there was some strong medicine in it. So he asked Titus to deliver the letter to Corinth and then to report back to him to let him know how they received it and if it had its proper effect. So Titus goes, he delivers the letter, and then as he's to return and report to Paul in Troas, Paul goes there to find Titus but could not find him. In fact, keep your place, but look at chapter 2 and verse 12. Chapter 2, verse 12. Paul says, "Now when I came to Troas for the gospel of Christ, and when a door was opened for me in the Lord, I had no rest for my spirit." Why? Not finding Titus, my brother. Paul was eager to get a report. He was concerned about the church. "But taking my leave of them, I went on to Macedonia." You can turn back to chapter 7. And so disappointed, Paul leaves for Macedonia, and as one scholar gives us some background, he says, Paul left for Macedonia, perhaps after he realized that Titus was not on the last boat of the season. This would have been about autumn time. At a certain point, they cut off any further ships going out because it got pretty choppy and dangerous in the winter. And Paul would now have to travel by land through Macedonia, and this would have been the case for Titus. And so Paul eventually finds Titus, and he gets a report, and the report was good. Praise the Lord. The Corinthians had repented. They took Paul's strong medicine and embraced it in a godly manner. In fact, they wanted to reconcile with Paul. It shows you the power of God's word and the Spirit of God, that he can change lives. And that's where the hope is, my friends. We don't have to be defined by our past and locked into our mistakes forever. There's always hope in the Lord, always. As long as the Lord is alive, there's hope. And by the way, he's always going to be alive. So we're pretty safe there. So Paul wants their relationship to be fully restored. This is mutual on both sides. So this is a good situation now, but some tough stuff had to occur in the interim, right? So if you look at verse 5, we're in chapter 7, verse 5. "For even when we came into Macedonia, our flesh had no rest, but we were afflicted on every side." Imagine, this is the godly apostle Paul. "Conflicts without, fears within." He's very transparent here. "But God, who comforts the depressed," think about that, that's how good he is, "comforted us by the coming of Titus. And not only by his coming, but also by the comfort with which he was comforted in you, as he reported to us your longing, your mourning, your zeal for me, so that I rejoiced even more." You see, Paul was not only comforted by the arrival of Titus with that good report, but he was comforted by the fact that he knew that God stepped in and did his work in the hearts and lives of the dear Corinthians. That's a beautiful thing. And that same God is alive today and still does the same thing. So if you find yourself at loggerheads with somebody and you say, I don't know what to do to solve this, take that to the Lord on a regular basis. Do your part humanly, from your end anyway. It may mean confessing or whatever the case is. But trust the Lord. You can't change the other heart, and you wouldn't want to do that. And don't manipulate it because you'll get in the way. Let God do what he does best. He transforms people. He's still doing it, my friends. There's always hope. And that's a praise to God. And so not only on an individual basis, but even on a corporate basis, when you know more people get involved, and you see, I've seen this, sadly, where you get two groups on separate sides of a given issue, and sometimes it gets to the point where the issue's forgotten, and now there's just people are locked in, and there's emotions involved, and all sorts of things. God can even dissolve that and unwind that mess and make something good out of it, where people can actually reconcile and become tighter friends for life than they were before. There's always hope. There's always hope. Need I say it again? There is always hope. Always. The question is, what are we going to do about it? Are we going to take it to him or try and handle it on our own or just put our head in the sand? That's where the different results occur, based on those choices. So Paul's rejoicing here, and rightly so, because he sees that they responded with godly repentance. And he talks about Titus' report, verse 7 there, he says, as he reported to us your longing, the Corinthians longed to see Paul, to ask his forgiveness for their close-heartedness. They longed to experience reconciliation with their, quote, spiritual father, Paul, the one who planted that church. And then he says, your mourning. The Corinthians were sorry for their toleration of sin. They were sorry and regretted their estrangement from the beloved Paul, who they knew that he loved them. They knew that. And then he says, your zeal for me. So in a spirit of repentance and reconciliation, the Corinthians are now on Paul's side and eager to promote and support his ministry, where before they were doubting him, bad-mouthing him, and kind of walking away from him. And so in verse 7, he says, so that I rejoiced even more. Paul rejoiced to see Titus. He rejoiced doubly when he learned of the Corinthians' desire to be reconciled. You see, godly repentance leads to reconciliation with others. And so I want you to think with me, what should we do when we have offended someone? I mean, what's the prescription there? We could just ignore it and hope it goes away and dissipates. Should we confess it to God and just leave it there? Well, that's getting a little better. We should confess it to God, no doubt about it. Should we leave it there? Or does repentance go farther than that? Well, here's a quote from MacDonald. I hope you find it helpful. Gordon MacDonald. He says, the Protestant penchant for privatizing faith and relegating confession to a singular transaction between that person and God has meant a loss of accountability. Anyone can breathe a silent prayer that amounts to little more than a sorry God and presume to get on with life. How, if things are to be so private and under the table, is the sinner and the sinned against to know if there has been any genuine sorrow and change of heart? I mean, on the human level, there's something valuable about two people hugging, although we got to be careful in this COVID day, but hugging from a distance, we'll put it that way, and just knowing that, hey, I'm forgiven, or to hear you are forgiven, or please forgive me, and I do forgive you. See, that's the human piece. Yeah, we can take it to God privately, and we should. I'm not against that at all. In fact, that's where it starts. But trying to get that relationship healthy again is where it needs to go ultimately. And that's the point when we privatize it and just leave it there, that piece might be missing. And so I have to ask myself, and you need to ask yourself, is there anyone in my life, in your life, with whom we need to reconcile? And have we done all we could do from our side of the fence, if you will, to make things right? Of course, we can't control anybody's response, but it sure helps to put your head on the pillow at night and know, Lord, I did all I can. If there's more I need to do, please show me. But if there's a blockage, Lord, you're going to have to work in their heart. I can't manipulate that, control that. That's up to you. This is where we trust in the sovereignty of God to do what he does best. But there is this human responsibility, and that's what I'm addressing here. We do have our role to play, and we need to act on that, because the longer it festers, the worse it gets, right? And it gets locked in sometimes into behavior patterns. The bottom line is godly repentance leaves no regret. And we're asking the question, well, why is that the case? And we've been considering here some reasons. First reason very clearly is because godly repentance leads to reconciliation with others. But here's the second reason, and that is godly repentance leads to rejection of sin. The thing that causes the mess, by the way, is sin. I cannot think in my later years in life, all these years thinking on this subject, I cannot think about one good thing that sin produces. If you got some answers, tell me afterwards. There's nothing at all good. And from every angle, I think about sin. There's nothing good in it anywhere. It's not desirable. It's in fact terrible and destructive. It destroys relationships. It weakens faith. And on that, there's wreckage all around with sin. So to turn from sin, in fact, to reject sin and to hate sin, the old phrase, love God, hate sin, applies here. It's a healthy thing. It promotes health and godliness. Now look at verse 8, and Paul says there, for though I caused you sorrow by my letter, that's that strong letter he sent them, I do not regret it, though I did regret it, for I see that that letter caused you sorrow, though only for a while. I'm sure as Paul wrote that letter, he had some second thoughts, like, I hope I wasn't too strong. But sometimes you have to do what you have to do. And he cared enough to do the hard thing. He says, I now rejoice, not that you were made sorrowful, but that you were made sorrowful to the point of what? Repentance. So the desired fruit came about. For you were made sorrowful according to the will of God. See, this is godly sorrow. So that you might not suffer loss in anything through us. You see, these Corinthians were in spiritual danger. They needed some strong medicine. And Paul's stern letter is just what they need, but I want you to know he could have been misunderstood, and that was part of his concern. But his heart definitely was love for them. In fact, let me show you real quickly. If you go, keep your place, go back to chapter 2, verse 4. You'll see his heart right there behind the letter. Chapter 2, verse 4, Paul says there, for out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote to you with many tears, not so that you would be made sorrowful, but that you might know, you see it there, the love which I have especially for you. You can turn back. Sometimes love looks just like the opposite. This is where knowing the person and knowing their character comes in handy. Because we can misread people because sometimes we feel a sting. But sometimes that sting is really love. Parents, children, you know what I'm talking about, right? How come mom and dad are so hard on me? They took away this or that or whatever. But they're doing it because they love you, and there's a desired fruit they want to see in your life, which you're going to enjoy yourself once you get in that right frame of mind. But it doesn't feel so good at the time, right? I'm from the old school. I've had many a spanking in my younger years. I didn't enjoy a one of those. But they did put me back in my right mind. And I'm thankful that my parents cared enough to get off the couch and turn the clicker and the TV off and deal with me instead of just saying, do your own thing, mess up your own life, you're on your own. That message is, I really don't care. Doing the tougher thing is an evidence that we actually care for the people we're working with, right? And this is the case for Paul here. He loves these dear Corinthians, despite the fact that they were turning their back on him. I mean, that's love. It's actually the love of Jesus Christ. For your notes, if you want it, Proverbs 27, verse 6. Proverbs 27, verse 6. Again, it looks like it's not love on the surface. Here it is. Faithful are the wounds. What? Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of an enemy. Didn't Judas kiss Jesus? Oh, how he must have loved Jesus. Look at those kisses. Nope. Oh, that guy must not like me because he's being rough on me. No, just the opposite. this is what you need, and he cares enough to do something about it. Other people are going to let you go. He cares. So we have to kind of go below the surface and see who's doing what and why, and ask the Lord for discernment. You know, this person has a good track record. I can see they care for me, and they're actually doing something about it. So we have to trust the Lord at the end of the day. So, you know, the surgeon's knife, it is regretful. It doesn't feel good, but there is a good result that comes when he carves out the thing that might have killed us. We've got to look beyond the immediate. To lead someone to repentance, I believe, is an act of love. And so rather than responding to Paul's letter with bitterness and self-vindication, these Corinthians respond with godly repentance, which leads to rejection of sin. They don't want to deal with sin anymore because that's what messed up their relationship with Paul and put them in a bad frame of mind, and on the list would go. Now, if you look at verse 10, notice how Paul words this. For the sorrow that is according to the will of God, this is godly sorrow now, produces what? Repentance without regret. Does that sound familiar? This is where I'm getting my points, right from the text. I didn't make this stuff up. Leading to salvation, but the sorrow of the world produces what? Death. Not a good thing. So there's a contrast here. One scholar fleshes this out. He says, the selfishness of worldly grief gives rise only to despair, bitterness, and paralysis. It causes our souls to drown in self-pity. Repentance implies remorse for sin, for sins that wound and anger God, and the desire to make amends and to desist from sinning again. You see, godly repentance leads to rejection of a bad thing, sin. And that's actually a good thing. That tells us we're spiritually healthy when we're in that frame of mind. Now, if you look at verse 11, he says, for behold what earnestness this very thing, this godly sorrow, has produced in you. What vindication of yourselves. What indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what avenging of wrong. In everything, this is beautiful, in everything, you demonstrated yourselves to be innocent in the matter. Wow. Let's go through this quickly. He says, what vindication of yourselves. See, the Corinthians were awakened out of their indifference toward their own sin. Sometimes sin, tragically, becomes a comfortable friend. It becomes our pet, and it's hard to extract from our lives because now we have an emotional investment. That's our security blankets. Believe it or not, that's how messed up we are. Sometimes a sinful pattern becomes a source of comfort. It's not a good place to be. See, they wanted to give an account in order to clear themselves. He says, what indignation. They were outraged over that ringleader I talked about who challenged Paul's authority. Remember when Paul went there, somebody spoke up and really let Paul have it, and the others didn't stand up for Paul. And so now they're thinking that through, and they realize that was all wrong, and they were outraged by their own complicity. One scholar says this, the troublemaker openly denounced Paul while the Corinthians either passively stood by and watched or secretly agreed with the malefactor. And so in either case, they're sorry for their behavior. What, he says, what avenging of wrong. The Corinthians, in effect, declared war on sin. They saw to it that all past wrongs were made right. You see, godly sorrow does lead to rejection of sin. And that's a great place to be. Now, you may have heard about the pastor and the music director in Old First Church. Sadly, they did not get along well, and it was not just style of music, although the worship pastor liked the hymns, the classic hymns. And so, one week, the pastor preached on commitment and how we should dedicate ourselves to service, and then right after the sermon, the music director led the choir in singing, I Shall Not Be Moved. Maybe not an appropriate one. The next Sunday, the pastor preached on giving and how we should gladly give to the work of the Lord. And the music director then led the song, Jesus Paid It All. The next Sunday, the pastor preached on gossiping and how we should watch our tongues. The following hymn was, I love to tell the story. The pastor became disgusted over the situation, and the next Sunday he told the congregation he was considering resigning, and the choir sang, "Oh, why not tonight?" Bad choice. When the preacher resigned the next week, he told the church that Jesus had led him there and Jesus was taking him away, and the choir then sang, "What a friend we have in Jesus." Well, that music director needed some godly repentance, didn't he? Well, that's a silly story, obviously, but the question is, how seriously do I take sin? And further, to what degree do I tolerate sin in my life? It's not even wise, and it's certainly not good, and that becomes the blockage in our relationship with the Lord and with others. Sin is not our friend. If there's anything we need to despise, it's sin. And thankfully, God gives us the resources to deal with it. We're not on our own here. It's not just a New Year's resolution. The Lord will gladly remove it if we ask. He'll work with us. There's no doubt about it. That's how good He is. And so, having a high tolerance of sin leads to many regrets. And what we're learning in our text today is that godly repentance leaves no regret. And we're asking, why is that the case? We're looking at the reasons. We've seen already that godly repentance leads to reconciliation with others. That's a good thing. Further, godly repentance leads to rejection of sin. And there's another great reason, and here it is. Godly repentance leads to respect for authority. That's a sign of health, by the way. Godly repentance leads to respect for authority, because God is behind all authority. He's the one who ordains people in power. Doesn't mean that person is doing their job the right way or they have character. That's a separate issue. But in terms of the position and the authority behind it, that comes from the Lord. So notice now in verse 12, he says, "So although I wrote to you, it was not for the sake of the offender, nor for the sake of the one offended, but that your earnestness on our behalf might be made known to you in the sight of God. For this reason, we have been comforted. And besides our comfort, we rejoiced even much more for the joy of Titus, because his spirit has been refreshed by you all." Notice verse 12 there. "That your earnestness on our behalf might be made known." See, they are finally submitting to Paul's God-derived, God-ordained authority. That's a sign of health. It's a sign that they have repented. Kent puts it like this: "True repentance and an altered course of action," which is a part of it, I would argue, "would bring God's approval, and this in turn would remind the Corinthians of the importance of heeding the instruction of Christ's duly chosen apostles." Submitting no longer becomes an issue when our hearts are in the right place. Godly repentance leads to respect for authority. And Paul wants them to be cognizant of God's omniscient gaze upon their lives. He says there, you see it in verse 12, "in the sight of God," and God wanted the Corinthians to see their indebtedness to Paul and their need to respect his authority as an ordained apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, that's a sign of something good going on in their lives if they're actually submitting to Paul. It has nothing to do with how great Paul is as a person, but it has something to do with his office. Verse 14, "For if in anything I have boasted to him," that is to Titus, "about you, I was not put to shame. But as we spoke all things to you in truth, so also our boasting before Titus proved to be the truth." You see, Paul was believing for the best in them, and he was proved right in this case. Paul was a consistent truth teller whose authority was worthy of trust and respect, and he actually felt that the Spirit of God was going to work in the lives of the Corinthians and that they would respond well, and in fact, most of them anyway, we don't know how many exactly, but most of them did. So Paul says in verse 15, "His affection abounds all the more toward you," talking about Titus, "as he remembers the obedience of you all, how you received him," that is Titus, "with fear and trembling. I rejoice that in everything I have confidence in you." Now, that phrase there, you see it? "How you received him," Titus, "with fear and trembling." You see, a strong indication of the Corinthians' repentant attitude was the way in which they received Titus and the way in which they obeyed Paul. That's a sign that they're in their right minds and they're seeing things aright and they're appreciating the fact that God sent these godly men to serve them, to bless them, and to watch out for them. That's one of the roles of an elder or a shepherd, is to watch out for their spiritual welfare, for their health. And so they received Titus with great respect as Christ's ambassador and as Paul's representative, because remember, he was sending Paul's letter to them, delivering it. And so with respect and humility, the Corinthians knew their place and willingly, don't miss that word, willingly submitted to Paul's authority. We're told in our culture that that's a bad thing. But actually, submitting to authority is a good thing. Now, there are some aberrations. We'll talk about that in a moment. But the idea here is godly repentance. One of the signs is there is a healthy respect for authority. And this is what they demonstrated in their lives. And so do I and do you willingly submit to our church leaders, to our employers, to our parents, to our teachers, to our government leaders? Now, you may be thinking, yeah, but you know what? I got to be honest. Some of my leaders are not worthy of my respect, and I would agree with you. Some of them, when you look at their character and even their decisions and maybe even their competency, as a person, they're not worthy of your respect. But they do have that office, and so what we do is we respect the office. This is borne out well. This has been the case through the years with the military. The commander-in-chief is the president, whoever that president is, and for those 4 years, 8 years, whatever. And if you were to interview each soldier, not all of them are going to agree with that president. They might even have a low opinion of him as a person, as a leader, as character, whatever. But still, if they were sitting down and having dinner with the president, it would be, yes, Mr. President, can I get you more? How can I serve you, Mr. President? Yes, sir. And they're going to take orders and do it, maybe not because of that person and his personality or lack of character, but because of his office. Does that make sense? We respect the office. Now, we don't do things that violate God's will. But we do recognize that all authority comes from the Lord, right? And there are abuses. This is the sin. This is the thing we want to reject. Because when authority figures are abusing their power, that is, begins with an S, sin. And this is what we want to reject. And we don't cooperate with that. But inasmuch as God has given them the authority, we do submit. And that's a sign, again, of spiritual health. And so disrespecting authority often leads to regret. And we're saying that godly repentance, that's the key, leaves no regret. So what have we learned? Well, we already mentioned that godly repentance leads no regret. That's pretty clear, but we want to explore it further and ask why. So we've considered three reasons. Godly repentance leads to reconciliation with others, rejection of sin, and respect for authority. The story is told of a famous rabbi who was walking with some of his disciples, and often they would walk behind and he would throw questions at them and they would respond. And as they were walking along, one of his disciples asked, "Rabbi, when should a man repent?" And the rabbi calmly replied, "You should be sure to repent on the last day of your life." Well, the disciples thought about that, and "Rabbi, with all due respect, we can never be sure what day is going to be the last day of our life. So, hello, what do we do? I don't know if I'm going to die today, tomorrow, next week, next year, 10 years. Repent on the last day. It may happen so fast, I might not have time to repent. Rabbi, what do we do?" Well, that famous rabbi smiled and he said, "The answer to that problem is very simple. Repent now. Now is a beautiful time." And I can never think of a good reason to postpone repentance, can you? Well, wait, maybe after this show, because wait, the game is the ninth inning. There's one more out. After that, then I'll repent. Well, I'm waiting in line for a cheeseburger. Once that comes, then I'll repent. It's immediate. Do it now, because it gets worse the longer we wait. Feelings get locked in, and the unraveling of life happens, and destruction and all that. Don't let Satan get extra mileage out of any sin. Oh, how many stories do you want? Oh, boy. I've been a pastor for a lot of years. Oh, wow. where people let it go too long and the family unraveled and now they're at loggerhead. They won't talk to each other. They won't go to each other's funeral. It's awful. Families who were once united, and even model families, you might say, over some stupid issue, and I do mean stupid issue, messed up everything because of pride and they weren't willing to repent. It's not wise. It's not smart. In fact, it's dangerous. And Paul saw this danger with these dear ones who he loved, and he did something about it. And so if there's something in my life or in your life from which we need to repent, dear friends, right now, even now in church, in the presence of the Lord, we can do that. If it's a case of making a call or whatever it is, let's do that. Let's have the courage to do such a thing. We'll be glad and better for it. As I say, we can't control the other side, but at least we can have a clear conscience. And yes, sometimes lives get transformed on both sides of the fence, and no longer is there a fence. That's how good God is. So, dear friends, we've learned that godly repentance leads to no regret, and that's the way I want to live. I'm not telling you I'm perfect, and I've got regrets, but I take those to the Lord, and if it's something I can fix, I will bring it to the person or whoever the case is and deal with it. That's the way to live. Let's speak to him in prayer, shall we? Lord, it's obvious you love us. I can name so many reasons. One of them is that you tell us things we need to hear, not what we want to hear. Thank you for loving us that much, like a loving parent, that you tell us what's good for us. Some of these things aren't easy, but you provide all the resources we need, and then you do the follow-through. And so, Lord, I pray for myself and my brothers and sisters here this morning. If you've been speaking to us today about someone we need to approach, or whatever the case may be, give us the follow-through, give us the faith and the holy courage to do this, primarily to honor you, but then to be a blessing to the other person. And we know that blessing is going to splash right back on us because you're just that good. So be glorified in the days ahead and exalted through our efforts, through our repentance, through our change of thinking, because you're worth it. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus, and all my brothers and sisters said, amen. Praise the Lord.
I'll invite you to stand with us as we continue in our time of worship together. We're going to sing some songs of worship and praise to our Lord. So thankful for Dr. Rock and his ministry. Appreciate that challenge this morning, Dr. Rock. Let's begin with just a couple of songs that focus our minds and our hearts on worshiping this holy God that we serve, starting with On You Stay.
Almighty grace.
Let's sing together. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Rock, thanks again for that wonderful encouragement. And as we sing the song, Holy, 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 we're reminded of the holy God we serve, the one we repent and turn towards. And so we praise him for working so powerfully in us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise you. We just lift our voices in worship after being reminded from your word of who you are, what you call us to, relationships not only with one another, but Lord Jesus, with you. So we praise you as we sing that we are reminded of your truth. We are reminded of your great love. We are reminded of your great sacrifice for us. Lord, even as we celebrate during this weekend of the freedoms that we have in our country, freedoms that were given to us through much great sacrifice, freedoms to even come this morning to worship together. But Lord, they pale in comparison to the freedoms that we have in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Freedom from sin, Lord, we worship you this morning. We lift our voices in praise, in holy praise to you and you alone. You are only the only one worthy of our praise. And we come to you this morning in the weakness of our sinful flesh, and yet we sing and worship you because you truly are a holy God. Amen.
There is no freedom like the freedom that Christ gives. And so we come to this song here this morning. I want to encourage you to sing along with us. I will glory in my Redeemer, thinking about what he has done in setting us free if we have placed our faith and our trust in him. You to join us in singing a last song, singing about our Redeemer and what he's done for us, Jesus Messiah. He became sin who knew no sin.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. Humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. The rest. body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing, Jesus Messiah.
Give him praise this morning with the clapping of your hands. He is worthy.